Hey, everybody, see if we'll start bringing some folks in. Sue, Valerie, hi, welcome. And we have Stanley K. Hey, Valerie, how you doing? Okay, flying solo here, we're standing by. Hi, Stanley K. Where are you coming on from? I'm not hearing you.
No, it's not Stanley, it's Cyril. It just comes up the name. I'll have to change it.
Oh, welcome. Okay, so I'm starting to admit some folks here. I'm glad I turned your volume on then. Okay, and very nice to meet you in the face as opposed to in the ear. Sounds terrible saying like that, but here we are. I'm just letting people in. And hopefully we'll have a nice audience for you. Is Marilyn going to be joining us?
She'll be joining us. She doesn't like being interviewed.
You'll have to come up. Bring up your volume just a little bit.
Bring up my volume. Very complicated questions here.
Present. Project.
Okay, Marilyn said she doesn't like being interviewed. Can you hear me now?
A bit more. You're still a bit soft, but we'll go with it. And who do we have on iPad 2? Do you have a name and picture? iPad 2? I now shows up as Cyril.
Yep.
Oh, you just changed it, I see. Okay.
Yep.
Anja? Okay, Anja's here, back from last week. Welcome, Anja. When I was a little child in America, some of you may know of this, you may know it, Cyril, you were in 23, 28 states, I don't know. A show called Romper Room, where you had Miss Jane or Miss June, and she had a little thing she held up, it was like a colander, and she said, I see you and I see you, and she'd name all the children in the audience. I didn't think I'd get to this part of my life where that was the real thing. Welcome, Mr. UK photographer. Okay, waiting for one or two more folks to come in, and then we will start. Just for folks who are coming in who may not have seen the headline, I've got a chat here and request. I am flying solo this evening, so I may have to dance around a little bit. So, hey, Liz, I cannot type and do all the rest at the same time here. And 10 fingers and they're, I feel like, how do they say, a one-legged man in a butt-kicking contest.
So, not a problem, don't worry about it.
And on that cheery note, welcome to Cyril Young. You are originally from where in the UK?
London.
From London, and you've lived longer than I have, I think, in Israel, and you've been all that time on Garin in Kibbutz Alumim.
That's right. I came to Alumim in 1971.
Wow. 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 Okay, I think I was 13 then, and I was here 72 to 73 in the Yom Kippur War, and then went back to America, and then made Aliyah a decade later. So yeah, you were there. Amazing, amazing. So tell us a little bit about yourself, about your family. You have a son, at least one son, I understand, was wounded on October 7th. So I give you the floor, Cyril Young from Kibbutz Alumim.
Okay, just by mentioning my son, we have five children, the youngest of which lives on Alumim, and he was wounded badly on Simchat Torah. They have four children. He and his wife have four children. And Hashem, he's more or less physically back to where he should be. About me, as I say, I came to Israel in 1971 as part of a Gaon of Bnei Akiva from England. And my wife followed 2 years later when we got married. I've worked all my life with machinery, agricultural machinery, and then later for making machinery for packing stations for fruits and vegetables. And now that I've retired, so I'm not retired, I'm now in charge of the kibbutz archives.
Well, that's a you certainly earned that.
It's a very, very interesting job.
So tell us a bit about your life there and bring us back, if you would, to the morning of October 7th.
Okay, this is how my October the 7th panned out. At 6:30 in the morning, we were woken up by a barrage of rockets. Now, we have a group of iron dome rockets about half a kilometer from the kibbutz. So we're used to hearing them go over. I can describe it as like standing on the runway of an airport and having the jet go over you. That's what it's like. But we heard these and they just didn't stop. It was going over and over. And it's like somebody had leant on the button to fire them and just stayed leaning on the button. And then soon afterwards, I heard small arms fire. And I thought, okay, this is something different.
Sure.
And then we started receiving WhatsApps. So it being Shabbat and Chag, I didn't open the WhatsApps, although I have a phone on the whole time. We all have phones on the whole time. And then I have a special ringtone for emergency messages. And when that rang, so then I picked up and we were told to go into our secure rooms and stay there. Now, our secure rooms are designed for a short stay. Normally, when we get a red alert, right, like we're being fired on, so we get the red alert, and either we hear it just after we hear the rockets go over or simultaneously. And we go in there, and we're there for 5 minutes. And by then, everything's over, and we come out. This time, we stayed in there. Well, I was in there until about 2:30 the following morning. I didn't turn the television on. I didn't. We didn't really know what was going on. We heard there were terrorists in the kibbutz, but we didn't know what was going on. About 12 o'clock, we get a phone call from the guys in charge of the defense. No, sorry, but from the woman who's in charge of I don't know how to describe it. Charge of social security. Okay. And she tells us that our son had been injured, moderately injured. This had happened at about 9:30. By this time, he was, huh?
Where did that take place? Do you know the
That
circumstances?
took place literally outside his house, 100 meters from his house. His house is on the edge of the kibbutz, and that it happened there. The terrorists were trying to, they blew a hole in the fence, and they were trying to get in, and he and a couple of others sort of kept them pinned down. The two of the others who were with him were both also injured. One had a couple of bullets in his leg, which didn't stop him carrying on for another couple of hours. And another, a grenade went off right by him and injured both his arms. Now, he was taken to the house behind our son's house, because there one of our nurses lives there. She's a midwife, but she managed to help stabilize him. And a few minutes later, my son was injured as well there, and he was shot. He was badly injured, very badly injured. He had a bullet went into just like near his shoulder, through his lung, five ribs, and out of his back. He shot the guy who was shooting at him, and somebody else, another guy was shooting at him, managed to get a couple of bullets in his back, and he had a piece of shrapnel through his cheek, which lodged in the base of his neck. He was again taken to this nurse's house. He managed to call up on the radio saying he'd been hit, and they managed to get him to the nurse's house. And she'd already run out of supplies, didn't know what to do. And eventually, one of the medical orderlies who'd come from his house with nothing but his medical kit said he has to be evacuated to hospital. Magen David Adom couldn't get to us. So the nurse's husband took him and the other guy who'd been badly injured in his car to Nativot. And from there, they were transferred to ambulances and taken to hospital. This we only found out about the following day. Anyway, about 12 o'clock, when we were told that he'd been injured, my wife was asked if she wanted to go over to our son and daughter-in-law's house to help with the children, because she'd just been stuck with four little children from the age of their, from six till two, in the safe room. And also we'd been planning to eat together on Chag, on Shabbat. Mm-hmm. So we had all the food in our house. So she said yes. And about 4:30, three soldiers, three of the members of our team came over and escorted her to the other house, to their house. And I stayed in our house. And she helped looked after the children. And then about 2:30 in the morning, we were told that it was more or less a lot safer. Most of the terrorists had been eliminated, and we were being evacuated. The whole kibbutz is being evacuated, and anybody who has their own transport, and my son has a car from his work, we can leave in about an hour and a half. Just get organized, pack a bag for 2 or 3 days, and that's it. So I packed the bag for 2 or 3 days, and my wife came back over and packed a bag. We went over to our son's house. I went and got his car, which I found had a bullet hole in the screen and a bullet hole in the driver's window, and got it back to their house, and we were ready to go. And then we were told, you know, it's been put off for another half an hour. It was put off until about 8 o'clock in the morning. We were told, okay, now you can go.
8 a.m.
8 a.m.
morning.
Sunday morning. Yeah, this is already 25 and a half hours afterwards the thing started.
Now, just for folks who are abroad, I wanted to explain briefly, the non-observant or non-Jewish among us, it's a religious kibbutz, and people commonly on the Sabbath won't answer the phones. And when there's an emergency, a life-threatening event, you are allowed. In fact, it's considered meritorious to do anything for life-saving. And I could tell it that my phone, my red alert was, like you said, it's like someone leaned their elbow on the button and just didn't get up. It just didn't stop, and I knew something was wrong, and I checked it. So you've, after 20, how many hours, then what happened?
25 and a half hours. So we said, okay, so we loaded the children and my wife and my daughter-in-law in the car. It was a problem with the car, because when I discovered in daylight, it had a bullet hole in the back door behind the driver, so I couldn't open that. There was no back window left. I couldn't open the tailgate, so I had to stuff the suitcases through the back window. And bullet holes all around, but mechanically the car was sound. Just to point out, this is a car that hadn't done 2,000 kilometers. And we went off to my daughter-in-law's parents in Ramat Gan. And we stayed there for the first 2 weeks while my son was, it was a week in intensive care, and wow, then a week in a regular ward. And then he transferred to a hospital in Tel Aviv for rehab. And that's when we moved up to Netanya.
Are you still and, in Netanya for an extended period?
We were in Netanya for 9 months, in a hotel in Netanya for 9 months.
We were treated
very, very well. They made every effort to make us feel at home. But in spite of that, a hotel's okay for a week, right, not for 9 months.
Adele can talk to that. She's just come on. Thanks for making time to speak with us, Adele. And she's on a speaking tour in the States right now. And Adele is our founder from Life on the Border, Cyril. And also, if you hadn't noticed, Linda Stern, you're in there. I see you. I see you hiding. She's there as well. Linda, for folks who may not know, B'nai Akiva is a youth movement, a Jewish observant youth movement, all over the world and in the UK, very popular. And Linda and Cyril and his wife, Marilyn, were in the same, the literal translation is colonel, but the same group, coalesced group, to make Aliyah to Israel together and start their lives together as a cohesive group and not an assembly of people like me that just kind of wandered into the country. Go on, please.
So anyway, that's basically.
I just want to pop in and say hi, Cyril.
Thank you so much for coming on and doing this. I am not in Israel at the moment. I'm on a 27-day speaking tour in the States. So to any of our followers, anyone who thinks that I'm going to be in their area, I've written it on the group. Please reach out to me and I'll see if I can get to see you. And so literally I had to pop in and have to pop out because I'm on my way out. But Cyril, your neighbors, right? From Alumim.
Yeah.
So thank you so much for coming on and sharing your stories and talking to our little intimate group in Life on the Border. But many more people will see it when it gets posted on the site.
That's right.
And stay strong.
Thank you.
Stay strong. Thanks. Thanks for everything, Dave.
Okay. Be well. Have a great trip. Talk well.
So anyway, basically that's my experience of Simchat Torah of October the 7th. As I say, we didn't really know what was going on. We were really in our safe room, and that was it. Basically, we were quite cut off from reality, as they say. Of course, a lot of other things happened on Alumim. There were 23 of our foreign workers were killed. We had suffered a lot of damage. Of all the kibbutzim that were damaged, we had the greatest financial damage. First of all, terrorists, before they got to Alumim, they destroyed our hothouses in the fields. They destroyed irrigation systems. And when they got to Alumim, they destroyed our brand new milking parlor. They shot holes in the milk tank so we couldn't milk. Our cows went 4 days without food or being milked, which is, as I can put it mildly, it's not very good for them. But I must say that we are back now to a level in milking that we were a year ago. We've managed to get everything back, as it were. And now the packing stations were destroyed. Our barns were burnt down. A lot. I think something in the region of 20 million shekels worth of damage.
I don't know what that is in pounds or euros, but
20 million. It's about 5 million pounds, $5 million. Around $5-6 million worth of damage. We're a strong chevra, strong like kibbutz, and we will get through this.
What's the security arrangements now around you at the kibbutz? I'm sure they're much more fierce and much more beefed up, but tell me what that's like for you.
Okay, we have soldiers now based permanently on the kibbutz. We have soldiers at the gate 24 hours a day now. The field, we are about 3.5 kilometers from Gaza. And there's a road, 232, that runs parallel to the Gaza Strip on which we are. We can't go without permission, without organizing it first, into the fields between the road and the Gaza Strip. There's anything west of the kibbutz that we have to get permission to go into. We have fields on the other side of the road which are okay. But we're limited in that respect.
You also have a museum and an andarta, a statue, a memorial to the early days of the kibbutz out in the fields on the eastern side of it. I visited there.
No, that's the kibbutz Be'erot Yitzchak. Kibbutz Be'erot Yitzchak, which was founded in 1943 and which was abandoned. It wasn't overrun, but it was abandoned during the War of Independence, because it was attacked by the Egyptians and very, very badly damaged. And the members decided to move and start somewhere else. Mm. And that's the reason why we are in Alumim today, is to replace that settlement. What's left of the settlement is only the water tower. Right. But we have on the kibbutz a heritage center, which I do guided tours of that as well.
Ah, okay. So you've been there. My wife and I had a really wonderful Shabbat. We came there in 2018, and we went and did all of that. We did the ride out to the water tower and the museum, and we did the whole Sound of Light show. So it was really, really good. And from there, we went to Yad Mordechai and so on. places.
Yeah. Well, so that's the Yad Mordechai. It's Berot Yitzchak. That's it. You know. Any questions?
Please.
As I tell when I do guided tours, I'll tell people you can ask me any questions. What I don't know, I'll make up.
Okay, I'll ask a question. I'm sorry, Valerie. Yes, unmute yourself. No, no questions. Sign language.
Okay.
Question, who paid for the damages? Did you get any assistance from the government?
Okay, the government set up a committee, whatever it is, called Tkuma, called Redemption, whose job it is to help recompense all these, the situation, help reestablish and get people back to where they were. Whether we will get the full cost of everything that has been damaged, I don't know. If we had a barn that was, say, 20 years old and it was worth X, but a new barn is worth Y, whether we'll get X or Y is still open to dispute. And everything else we'll have to make up or find the money ourselves.
Are you finding the money yourself? Adele, for example, I'm sorry she had to jump off. She's on that speaking tour to raise money for Kibbutz Nirim. Are the other kibbutzim and alumim doing similar tours and visits to raise funds privately?
We would like to have a help. Yes, we are looking for help. But I hope the government will do its job and recompense us for everything.
Two questions here. Great, from Valerie. Thanks. Okay. How are the children? Have they started school?
Okay, the children, yes, the children have gone back to school. And, well, when we were in Netanya, we had our own school. We set up our own school. So the kids haven't missed school as far as that's concerned. And they've now gone back to the school they were in the beginning, yes.
So physically, the same physical plant, the same location.
Yes, well, our younger children, go to school on Kibbutz Ayal, which is just up the road. So the kids have gone back to school on Kibbutz Ayal, and our youngest grandson, he's in the children's houses here, and he's quite happy there. Yes. That's
great to hear. The reason I ask is also because there are tens of thousands of children in the north that are in nothing like that kind of circumstances.
When we were in Netanya, in the hotel in Netanya we were in, there were a lot of people from Kiryat Shmona. And I feel really bad for them because they're stuck there and they don't know when they can go back. We at least knew, you know, when the school year finishes, then we'll go back. But people in the north, they're really in a bad way.
Especially really in the bad that aren't evacuated. There are a whole. We had someone on last week, a neighbor of mine from a village not far from here, who's not in the war zone, not in the 5 kilometers from the border. Them, it's like, but everything's up in the air. Where do they go to school? With the refugee kids, without the refugee kids? It's a disaster, frankly. Kids have lost a year of schooling, just put it that way.
Yeah. Well, that's what we were fortunate in, that we had our own school. We set up our own school, and we had like some of the members who had been teachers and had retired had come back and helped teach, and that was very well organized. Yeah.
Are you creating a GoFundMe of some sort online?
I don't know.
Okay.
That's not my, there is somebody who's in charge of looking for funds, and it's not me.
How do you?
But as they say, all contributions greatly accepted.
So then you need to send me links that I will post on the Facebook page for anyone who wants to donate, who to contact, what the mechanism is. Okay.
Okay. I will find that out and let you know. I will find it out and let you know. Sure.
Linda is there. She doesn't want to speak, I guess. She says, how is it?
I can't speak. I mean, am I angry? Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Hello, Cyril. How are you doing?
Hi, Linda. Hi.
It was my idea for Dave to reach out to you. I said to myself, you're a good guy to interview. And also the fact that Ayal was badly injured, preserving the kibbutz. I wanted to know how he was.
Well, I'll put it this way. The first Shabbat he was back, on Friday night, the guys in charge of the services came up to him and said, are you okay to blow shofar this year? And Ayal said, yes.
Oh, it's a chamud.
That's shofar for, I mean, I know is the ram's horn that's used, the Jews blow on the on Rosh Hashanah, the New Year. How do you feel being in your own old home again? What were the first days, hours like?
Well, when we got back, I said, it took me a couple of days to get used to being home. But I'm back to everything, back to normal now. But it was funny being home, you know. I had to, you know, tidy my own bed, do my own washing up, clean my own room. It's nice being in a hotel.
Adele had spoken about that quite a bit because she was moved around in several locations. She was in Eilat for a period. Now they're in an apartment building, a new apartment building in Be'er Sheva. And she goes back and forth to Nurim quite often. Question, iPad photographer. Who manned the gap in the kibbutz fence after your son and friends were injured so the kibbutz was not overrun? Good question.
Well, I don't know. I don't think it was mad. It was just, I think, well, first of all, the guy that my son shot, he was like the leader of the terrorists that came in. They found in his pockets, they found maps of Kibbutz Alumim with the names of all the houses, all the people living in the houses on it. And once he'd been dealt with, they seemed to maybe lose a bit of heart and they didn't get to the houses of the members, except for one guy who got round to somebody's house. One terrorist got into a house and shot the member there, but he was, as they say, very swiftly dealt with. But we managed to hold them off. The other members of the responders managed to hold them off until the army arrived later and helped clear up.
You know, I wonder about that because did Kibbutz Alumim, like many of the other kibbutzim, employ Palestinians from Gaza to work in or with the kibbutz in various fields?
We didn't. We have a Bedouin with that. But we were building, the council were building us a new children's house. And apparently some of the workers there came from Gaza. And we think that's how they got the information. You know, they weren't employed by us. They were employed by the council.
The regional council. Someone speaking? Okay. Someone's pointing out there's sirens in the north now, and I'm well aware. Just literally as we came on air, there was a barrage of either rockets. I have to check it out more closely.
We hear the booming here in Lviv.
Oh, you're in Lviv. Oh, okay, John Oberman from Lviv. Welcome.
Johnny is one of our greatest friends, and I sent the link to him, and I knew he'd come. Hi, Johnny.
Hi, Johnny.
This is Johnny.
Yeah, lovely to speak to Cyril.
Have some beers together, you know, and clink them.
Go back a long time.
Yeah.
What, 50 years ago?
Wow.
Yep.
A lot of history,
more than
life lived.
Did
you ever think you'd get to a point where you're telling your story like this? I mean, you're where you are, and John is about, 20 kilometers south of me. He's hearing the booming that I'm not hearing at the moment out my open window, and I'm far closer to the Galilee Panhandle where the attacks were taking place. It's very interesting like that. Maybe the lay of the land. I don't know. Okay. Ayal, by the way, is not with us because it is put the children's to bed hour. So he's with the wife and the kids and dealing with that. So he could not be live with us. Perhaps on another occasion, he'll be able to join us. Any other questions folks have? Time is going to start running short. I'm hearing someone speaking. If you could type it, it would probably be better, or speak up. I'm hearing someone. I feel like I'm having a seance here. Who are we chatting? Is that Liz? New message. Hang on. Do high school students go in Sderot? Your high school, where do they go to school?
No, our high school students, either they go to the Kibbutz High School in Kibbutz Yavneh, or they go to wherever they or their parents want them to go to. But of our children, two went to Yavneh, one studied in Be'er Sheva, one studied in Chafetz Chaim, and one studied in Meron.
In Meron, that's the other end of the country, that's up by me.
Yeah. He wanted to get far away. But no, the education, the way your children go is purely is up to the parents.
This may be a moot point at this point, but, and I will answer your question there as well. Do you and Marilyn, do you have moments in when you were in Netanya wondering, is it time to move on to stay here in Netanya? Find another little village,
never.
Move into, or
no.
Come hell or high.
The answer is no. The answer is no. That's it. Yeah, we always wanted. The only reason we stayed so long in Netanya was because of the children, because my son and daughter in-law both worked, and the children, you know, take to school, get them back from school in the afternoon, and they have various activities in the afternoon to help look after them. As soon as they left Netanya, we left Netanya.
Okay, not that it was a bad place.
It was okay. Yeah.
You're not going to leave a bad
place. We were a good place. We were right on the square, a very nice hotel, right on the square in the center of town. Lovely.
Okay, I had to mute you, John. Just hearing you cross. Ange has two questions, and Valerie has a question. Anja asks, has there ever been a feeling of abandonment by the government since the Hamas took over and fired rockets, especially after October 7th?
We felt we were very badly let down. And it was a big loss of confidence in the government and in the army. And I think even now, that's what they have to prove to us. But they can take care of us. They can, you know, keep us safe. I think the army is doing its best, really are. I don't want to go into politics here, but I think the government could do better.
Wasn't my intention. The question was not intended to go into politics. I just wanted to know how you feel.
I understand.
And as a related note, Valerie asks, how are the soldiers? Are they disheartened or quite positive? I guess she means the soldiers that are on the kibbutz or surrounding you?
Well, the soldiers on the kibbutz, they're a nice bunch of guys. And I think they're quite happy not to be, in Gaza. They're much happier being with us. Generally, you get the feeling that the soldiers are very motivated. And they're doing the best they can, in spite of the fact they've been in Miluim, in the reserves for so long, and they've been called again and again. They are, as I say, highly motivated and doing a very good job.
Anja asks, are the cows back on track, or did some die over the neglect of the 40?
A couple of them did die, and a couple of them we had to cull because they'd been badly affected. But the rest of the herd is back now to where it was as far as production is concerned and health. Where it was a year ago.
Really, that's amazing. Because
it's absolutely amazing.
When I lived on kibbutz ages ago, I remember working for 2 weeks in the refit in the cow shed, and I mean, you are married to those creatures. You all your life and children and family and wives and husbands, they're secondary. It's them. I mean, everything. It's like having a dog, but they can crush you and they don't even know. Are there any studies or records on the environmental damages? I think there are, but maybe Cyril knows more as the archivist.
As far as I know, there's never been a case of cows being not fed and not milked for 4 days in the like this. I presume there will be people writing theses about this in the future.
I'm sure. I was wondering, as a beekeeper, because when we were there, we saw beehives out in the fields, and many of them had been burned because of the balloon terrorism of the previous years.
Yeah.
And we visited there. We were very curious about that. If they were tended, if the beekeepers could get out to the hives, and if they were able to bring in honey. That's when I mentioned Yad Mordechai is a kibbutz up the road from you guys, and they're one of the centers for honey production in Israel. And they buy from a lot of villages and kibbutzim all over the country.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. Any new plans, Liz? Asking, and we're getting very close here. I may get cut off, and I really apologize if I do. Any new plans for the army as they're used to shorter spans of activity? How's the longevity of the war as it continues going to be addressed? I think that's a question I'd like to answer or send you information on that separately, because this goes on, that unfolds into a big, big issue of what's going on next in the war. Israel is used to hard, fast conflicts, 6-day war, 73 war. We don't have economically, logistically, a long enough tail going out, and certainly not this time with the U.S. government not sending weapons and munitions that were crucial for the war effort, just to slow Israel down, said, no, you don't. So that's a big question. This isn't the time and place for it, unfortunately. Thank you so much, Valerie says, and thank you all for being with us, and certainly Cyril. And
you as well.
Marilyn, Johnny.
Regards to all the chevre there.
Okay.
Thank you, Johnny.
You're close by. You're welcome to come up. You made the furniture in our Beit Knesset, in our synagogue. They have a major factory.
Anyway, it's lovely to listen and hear everything. And we wish you well and hope to see you all in Lavi.
Thank you, Johnny. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody, for being with us, for your questions and your interest. And looking forward. I will put up notes about next week and who we'll have, if we'll have anyone. And if you have any ideas for guests that you'd like to see, please shoot me a note. You all know that I'm very responsive. I'm more responsive than I am to some of my family. So please, thank you all, and take care of yourselves as well. Thank you, Liz and Valerie and Anja and everybody else who was speaking here and the ones who weren't. Have a good evening.
Thank you, Dave. Bye.
Have a great week.
Bye.
Be well.